So welcome. As you guys trickle in, feel free to drop your name and grade level and any experience you might have with VR in the chat. And if you're a teacher representing a class, just let us know what grade your class is. We'll get started in a couple minutes.
Awesome. We got one high school jumping in. Who else do we have? Go ahead and tell us who you are in the chat. Oh, welcome, Toronto. We got Cape Cod. All right, welcome, New Jersey. Awesome, we got an eighth grade, probably a middle school. Wow, welcome Nigeria. Exciting. Gosh, what time is it over there?
Probably like 8 o'clock or so in the evening. If I had to guess, 7 p.m.
Oh, good. Yeah, pretty close, dude. Mm-hmm. Oh, that's awesome. Thanks for staying up with us. Excited to have you.
All right, one more minute and we'll get started here.
Teachers, if you got any of our info through email from your registration, then you're welcome to get your students logged in if they have CodeHS accounts that will allow them to save their work. So that's something that everyone can be doing now. If they don't have CodeHS accounts, that's okay. We can still participate in all the exercises today and they can get accounts later. But yeah, this is a good time to get everyone logged in if possible. And also being a VR experience today, we know that all schools and districts will have different policies around mobile devices, but there is actually additional functionality that can be done today on mobile devices, tablets and phones, but also everything can be done from a computer, a Chromebook, all those devices will be fine.
All right, so let's go ahead and get started here. So on the call today, myself and Daryl, and we also are joined by Claire. And so we're gonna talk a little bit about virtual reality, but just to give you a little bit of background, I am based here in Baltimore, Maryland, and I'm a curriculum developer with CodeHS, and I have done a lot of work on getting the A-frame units and the A-frame lessons set up and running. I'll let Daryl introduce himself and kind of get us started.
Hey everyone, thanks for joining us. It's awesome to have you. Hope you're having a great CS education week. And we at CodeHS are just excited to get to just touch base with all of you out there and do some fun experiences together. I'm also a curriculum developer here at CodeHS. I work on a lot of our elementary middle school curriculum. I'm excited to get to do a little bit of ER together with you all as well. Cool. So yeah, let's jump in. Just kind of to do a high level overview. Probably we have a whole spectrum here of experience with VR, but what exactly is VR? VR is an immersive 3D computer generated environment, which a user can interact with as if it were a real physical environment. So more than just like a 3D game like Fortnite or Minecraft, VR is when you're actually getting more immersed in the environment such that you have more physical and even cognitive immersion in the environment such that when you move your head, then the environment is actually moving to turn along with you. And so that's kind of the difference of getting more into the virtual reality, more into that immersion that we're going to get to play around with a little bit today. So what are some ways that VR is used? So obviously what comes to mind for many of us is games. Getting that immersed experience in a game is something that, you know, really gets you even deeper into that feeling of being there, and that the emotion and the experience, it gets all the more richer when you have that full type of immersion. And so clearly, many people who are into VR can actually create the most dynamic and exciting experiences through games. But there's a lot of other uses as well. And so, of course, for simulations, for expensive or dangerous projects, then such as even flying a helicopter or flying an aircraft, then using simulators that use VR, it can be a lot more immersive, a lot more effective in training than even just doing it on a regular screen without having that kind of full immersion visually and spatially. Similarly, for other learning experiences, being able to actually almost physically manipulate an object using VR is one of the other things that are being explored in a lot of different industries, such as medicine. Being able to actually manipulate something like a heart is going to be extremely difficult in real life, but in virtual reality can be really helpful for students who are learning about the human body. Over here on the right, another learning experience. This is actually a UPS driver. And so to be placed in all the different types of situations that type of role might place you in is impossible. But with virtual reality, all of the different things that could come up in being someone in a very dynamic and changing environment and situation, you can actually get trained on that. And then actually getting to visit places or see and experience things that would be very expensive or impossible to reach is another one of the huge applications of VR. And there's a lot of different companies and even, you know, Google doing Google Expeditions, giving you possibilities of how to actually place yourself in a place that would be otherwise very difficult to go to. Couple other interesting applications are around helping humans to grow or to adapt or even to heal. And so there's been a lot of uses of VR being tested in different types of therapies, say around fears or around post-traumatic stress disorders, and helping people in a safe way kind of get closer to the things that actually cause fears that are kind of that could actually be reduced by having that gradual closeness. And so you see here someone actually touching someone with like a fake spider and actually giving them that experience of proximity and seeing that it's actually safer than what their fears are actually telling them. And then also on the next slide, this is a really interesting work that was started a few years ago for amputees. And so when someone has a limb that needs to be amputated, then often actually in the majority of cases, a lot of times there's what's called a phantom limb. And so where the brain still thinks that you have that limb and you can actually have phantom pain. And some of the experiences have been where it feels like the pain of clenching your fist really, really hard and not being able to get rid of that pain, even though that arm doesn't even exist. And so researchers have used VR to actually hook them up to the VR that simulates them having that arm and simulates a virtual arm actually opening up that hand that doesn't actually exist, and the brain actually being tricked into thinking, I don't have that pain anymore, or actually maybe healed into that experience. And so really, really fascinating therapies that have been able to be experimented with VR. And also just different ways of accessing creativity, building with different types of modes and three-dimensional work that could be done using VR in a simulated environment as well. So with all of those really fascinating applications and research, I'm going to hand it back over to Dave, and he's going to actually get us dive in and actually find out a way that we can actually start to quickly and easily use VR ourselves.
Great. Thanks, Daryl. So one of the ways we can use VR, and one of the ways that it's made really accessible, is with this language called A-Frame. And A-Frame's been around for about 6 years now. And it was really designed, just like Google Cardboard was designed, to help people get easy access to VR on their headsets. A-Frame was designed to help people get easy access to development. So A-Frame makes this easy by allowing you to use HTML commands in your web browser to understand it. And then behind the scenes, these commands get translated using a JavaScript library. And so the great thing about A-Frame is that you can create these objects using just basic HTML commands without having to really understand the JavaScript library. And today we're just going to kind of look at the start of that and then kind of give you a spot to continue if you want to. So how does it work? Well, so using HTML tags, such as this A-sphere tag, you can create a 3D sphere. So notice that there's an opening tag with some attributes and a closing tag immediately following it. We'll walk through this a little bit later, some of the different parts of the tag. We just wanted to kind of show you what it looks like right now. In a second, we'll give you a chance to kind of explore the worlds, the A-frame world a little bit. But before we do that, I want to give you a sense of how you move around in this world. So once you get into your 3D world, we can move around by clicking and grabbing the screen with our mouse. This is kind of like turning your head left and right because we don't actually have a headset on with our computer. We can't put our computer screen on. We actually need to simulate that using the mouse and kind of grabbing the screen and moving it. Now the W, A, S, and D commands also will move you around, and the arrows actually work as well. But W and S will take you forwards and backwards, and likewise, A and D will be like stepping left and right. So let's take a quick look at what this is going to look like in the browser. Hold on a second, I'll pull my browser up. Okay, so looking at this in the browser here, when you open it up, you can click this open window here. So let me just give you an orientation on the browser. So if I click run, I'm going to run it just in this little part of my screen here. If I click open, I'm actually going to open it up into a new window, which is going to be a little bit bigger and easier to navigate. While I'm in here too, I can also look at different things like the docs tab and the more tab, and I'll talk a little bit more about those later. This part of my screen is where my code that I'm writing is going to run. I can run it using the run button here or the open button. I also have a list of files here. For today, we're only going to have one file. And so you can click this button here and that goes away. Like I said, there's a JavaScript that runs behind it. And that's this line right here. We're going to create our scene, this A scene here, and all of our tags that we're going to put in here go into this box here. So I'm creating a box, a sphere, a cylinder, and a plane, and putting them all here. And let me come over to this screen here. And again, if I click and hold, you'll see my hand changes from an open hand to a closed hand, kind of showing how I've grabbed the screen. Then I can move it around as if I'm looking around in the screen. If I want to walk forward, I hit the W key and I go forward. If I hit the S key, I can go backwards. Now, forward and backwards is depending on which way I'm looking. So if I turn my head and look that way, forward is now that way. If I come back here and turn this way, forward will be now this way. Okay. But the sidestep keys A and D basically just take you sidestepping. If I want to go around and see this here, I can kind of move as I turn and sidestep and then kind of walk forward and I can get to a different angle on my screen. Okay, so that's the basics of what we're looking at. Let me go back to our screen here. Okay, so one other thing that I'm gonna show you before we get started is our 3D coordinate system. And so we're now in three dimensions. We have to represent both the X dimension, the Y dimension, and the Z dimension. So our X and Y are like what you would see in math with the Y, positive Y going up, the positive X going to the right. But we also have the Z dimension. And the Z dimension, you can think of it as going in and out of your screen. So positive Z comes out of your screen, negative Z kind of goes back into your screen there. Okay, and one way that we can help to remember these easily is using what we call the right hand rule. So if you actually hold your right hand up, then put your thumb out, your index finger and your middle finger out, and they're all going to point to the different directions that the axis takes you. So the positive X direction is going to be your thumb, the positive Y direction is your index finger, and the positive Z direction is your middle finger as it points to it. Okay, so we're going to use these here to help get us started. And one thing to keep in mind is that you're always looking at a camera. And as you move around, you're essentially moving that camera around. So A-frame represents this camera as your point of view. And when you first run, the camera is actually set at 0, 1.6, and 0. The 1.6 is essentially representing the average height of your eyes. So it's all in meters. 1.6 is about 5 feet, 3 inches. And that's about the average height of your eyes. And so that's kind of the default position of the camera. Now it's important to know that that camera starting point, if you actually put something there, you can actually put something on your screen that you won't see. And so you have to remember that if that's where the camera starts, you want to position your objects so that you can see them. So again, that camera position is represented right there. And it's very easy to place objects out to the side. So if I start with an object way over here and I'm right here looking backwards at my Z, I'm not going to see it. Now, for the first examples that were set up, you actually see the objects right away, but when you start creating your own, you might have that issue. All right, so let's get started. So to get started here, you're going to have, you're going to use this link, this codehs.com/HOC_VR. You can use this link either logged in or logged out. And as Daryl explained earlier, if you're logged in, your work will get saved. If you're logged out, it won't get saved, but you'll still be able to participate the same. You'll still be able to do everything that you need to do. So for right now, what I want you to do is go ahead and follow this link. We'll post this link here in the chat. And then once you follow this link, get started. You can skip the first video because it's kind of what we just talked about, but take a few minutes to play with the examples. So we're going to take about 5 minutes to play with the first two examples. Then we're going to come back and I'm going to show you a little bit more of some of the objects and give you a little bit more time to create your own world after that. So again, we'll post our link and we have the link posted in the chat. So go ahead and get yourself logged in, play around with the first few examples, and we'll see you in a few minutes. All right, so we're going to get started looking at designing our projects. So as you saw in the examples, there's a couple spheres there. We're going to look at a couple different objects that we can use, and I'll show you where you can get some information on some more as you want to dive into it. So here's our sphere that we talked about earlier. So notice that we create a sphere using the A sphere tag shown in black here. Inside the opening tag, we can also see a set of different attributes for our sphere. So what are attributes? Well, attributes are used to modify how an element appears in A-frame. And one of the things that's nice about A-frame is that if we don't specify an attribute, it has a default value, and we can specify certain attributes to change those default values. So here, attributes are modifying our objects. In this case, we're telling A-frame to create a sphere at position 0, 1, negative 5 with a radius of 1 and a color of red. So let's take a closer look at each of these attributes. So our position uses the same set of coordinates that we talked about earlier. In this case, we have three coordinates that represent x, y, and z positions in that order. So a position of 0, 1, and negative 3 is going to represent 0 for x, up 1 on the y-axis, and backwards away from our screen, minus 3 on the z-axis. So the coordinates are put inside quotes and are separated by a space only. So no commas, just one single space separating each of them. So the radius is set similar to position, but we only use one number. So remember, as you move an object closer or farther away from you, the size is going to appear bigger or smaller. And one thing to note is that all of these units are in meters. So Daryl talked about, you know, if you have your phone and you have a Google Cardboard and you want to actually see these in VR on your phone, you can do that. But you have to keep in mind that what might seem like a small ball to you here or a small sphere may actually be very big. So if we had a radius of 3, well, that ball would actually be almost 10 feet tall. And if you put a headset on, you'd actually see that ball and you'd have to really look up tall to see it because it would actually feel 10 feet tall to you. So the final attribute that we're going to look at is color. And again, this is represented inside quotes. So color can be a name such as blue, but it can also be a hexadecimal code. So you can look at the color picker, like the one that you can find in the docs tab. And I'm going to show you this in a second. And you can take that hexadecimal color and find the specific color that you want and make that ball that color. So let's take a look at this in the editor and we'll get you guys a chance to start creating your own worlds. Okay, so here we have our editor where we're creating, this is our second example where we created two different spheres here. So I'm going to run this here and we can see our two different spheres. I'm just going to focus right now on the one sphere. So I'm going to delete that one. And again, we said that we can change our position. So right now this is at minus 20 with a radius of 2. If I bring this blue ball closer, you're going to see that by running that, the ball is going to appear to get bigger, but it's actually no bigger. It still has a radius of 2. It's just now closer to me. I can increase this radius to 5 and my ball will get bigger. And then again, I can push it back to minus 20 and it'll get smaller again. Okay, now remember I said you have to be careful because you can put the ball at a position where you can't see. So if I kind of go off to the right here, let's say minus 10 or positive 10, that's going to take me off to the right on my x-axis. So I can see it's still on the edge there. And if I, again, if I move it to like 40, I'm not going to see it here. So I run it, it doesn't look like I have anything there, but if I grab my screen and turn my head, I should eventually see it. Actually, I think I'm going the wrong way here. There's the ball. So it's still there. I just have to turn my head to see it. And so you want to keep that in mind as you create things. You want to generally put them where you're looking. So you're starting off at that 0, 1.6, and looking in the negative z direction. Okay. Now to create different things, we can add different objects. Now the best way to add an object is to look at our docs tab. So our docs tab has, and actually, let me show you the color picker first. So our color picker, if we come here, we can actually come over to here and pick any color we want. So if we want like a nice pinkish color, we can come here, we pick that, and then we can pick this scroll bar here, and we just click it a couple of times, we get the hexadecimal. I can then copy that over, put that in my, copy that over here. And then when I run it, I'll get that nice pink ball. Okay, so again, you can use that. That's under the docs tab, you'll see this color picker. But also under the docs tab, you're gonna see different things. So adding a sphere, adding a plane, adding a box. So if I wanna add a box, for example, I'll have an example of that box right here. I can come over and paste that. And notice that the box now takes a position like the sphere did, but now it has a depth, a height, and a width. And if I go ahead and run this, you're gonna see what looks like just a rectangle. That's because we're looking at it straight on. If I actually move off to the side here and turn my head, I can now see that I have that box there. We also have things like adding the sky, adding a cone. And if you wanna even get into it, you can look at animations and interactions. So animations give us the ability to do things like spin around, get our object spinning and things like that. So you can play around with whatever you want, but the docs tab is gonna be kind of the place that you go to find most of this information. We're gonna give you some time to work on this. When you're done, if you wanna share it out, you can share it with your teacher or you can share it with your class or you can share it with us by posting it in the chat. If you're not online and your teacher is, you'll need to kind of send it to your teacher to share. And the way you do that is under this more tab. And I have a few more here than you might, but there's a share button here. And when you click that share button, you get to create a link. Then you just wanna make sure that you say public on, and then you can share that with us and we will preview some of those out. So go ahead and feel free to create what you need. As you're doing this, if you do have questions, you can ask your teacher, they can post them in the chat for us and we can answer them. And then in a few minutes, we'll let you know when it's a good time to share links out. Okay, if there's any questions now, we'll take those. Otherwise, we'll let you get going. And I'm gonna post back on this presentation some information to help you remember where you're looking at. Okay, so again, this is where you're going to want to go for some more information. Go over to the docs tab. You'll get a whole bunch of information up and running to help you get going. And again, if you have more questions, feel free to drop them in the chat. It's just about half past the hour right now. And so about 20 minutes or so, we'll remind you about sharing and go from there. Just to clarify, you should be kind of finishing up working through some of the exercises. And then when you get to the make a scene, that's the exercise where you're really going to kind of create your own world. And so just continue working through that hour of code that way.
All right. Hey, everyone. Hope that you're having some fun. Keep going. Keep coding your world, your scene that you're creating. But I do want to just show you real quick. If you're interested, you can actually get whatever it is that you are programming now onto a mobile device. And so to do that, you actually do need to be logged in to a CodeHS account. So if you don't have a logged in account, then you can do that after this session and create a free account. But we once you are logged in, then what you can do is basically grab the URL from this Make a Scene exercise and just email it to yourself or get that link to yourself, however you can. So here I have it in my email. And when I open it up, it's going to open up my browser. The browser may have you log into your CodeHS account on your mobile device. And so that might be another step. I'm already logged in. I'm going to go ahead and go to Let's Go so I can view my exercise. And then you'll see a little mini coding window that I have on my phone. And if I tap open, then open will go ahead and open it up like in VR mode. So now I'm looking at my scene. I kind of started the soccer scene and I have the ball. And when I'm tilting my phone, I can be looking around at the scene that I'm creating. So you can continue coding. And when you save your changes, it'll show up again in this browser mode as well when you do that. So something you can try out now or later with any of the projects that you're working on in CodeHS. We did get student who teacher who was able to share a project with us. Teachers, if you have any cool projects that you want to share with us, definitely grab that link from the More tab and then the Share button. And you can throw it in the chat if you can get those links over to us. We can showcase a couple of them. But otherwise, we'll give you a few more minutes to finish up the scenes that you're building. And hopefully we can look at a couple of them that any of your students are making. If you can share them with us in the chat, definitely let us know if you have any other questions. And we'll check back in a few minutes.
All right, so Daryl's going to share a few examples out, and then we're going to wrap up here in a minute.
All right, cool. Awesome. Hope you guys had a great time. Hope that you got to actually do some world building. If you do want to throw anything in the chat for us to check out, we'd love to see any links of projects that you all are creating. And also, you're welcome to tag us at CodeHS. Also, hashtag CS Ed Week, hashtag Hour of Code just to kind of participate in the global community of coding that's happening this week. Just want to show some of the work that's been going on. So right as we just barely got started, we got this project shared with us. Someone got their first spheres going on, and it seems like this is kind of maybe even some like a character, maybe some kind of dystopian snowman or something. some other examples of what's possible, probably not in the short amount of time that you all had today, but you can actually even create something like a pinball game. And this is all done in our platform on A-Frame. A lot of amazing, cool possibilities, even just using these HTML tags. This is another example where, as Dave mentioned, you can start to use textures, you can start to use animation to get some spinning. So just some really, really crazy, awesome, fun possibilities here to do as you get explore and continue building more and more complex and more fun worlds to immerse yourself in. So with that, thanks so much for joining us. And Dave, you want to take us out?
Sure. So if you want to continue on with virtual reality, you can continue finishing up through the Hour of Code. We also have a short, maybe about 4-week course with virtual reality that you can find in our course catalog. It really gives students a great place to kind of get started, get a little bit deeper into the language, and then kind of go from there. And if you actually want it to be a little bit more than 4 weeks, you can kind of dive into some bigger projects and look more at what you can do by checking out the A-Frame website, which is aframe.io from there. If you want more of a full semester in kind of getting into 3D types of things, you can also look at our Unity game design, which also kind of touches on 3D. It doesn't get into virtual reality as much, but you can actually use Unity for virtual reality, and so you can tie it in that way. But right now, you know, the virtual reality course that we do have out there in the catalog is about a 4-week course, and it's a great course to kind of fill in, especially towards the end of the year if you're taking AP classes and things like that. And so thanks again for joining us, and we hope you have a good time exploring virtual reality.